Warning, the following Otaku Generation podcast has content of an adult and mature nature, and is not necessarily safe for work or appropriate for children under the age of 18. If you are easily offended by content of this type, please stop this recording. Parental discretion is advised. The opinions and viewpoints expressed on Otaku Generation are those of the cast and crew and the individuals that express them, and are not necessarily associated with the sponsors or guests of the show. Otaku Generation is a Red Apple production, which is solely responsible for its content. All impressions are poorly impersonated, and please, for the love of God, don't try this at home.
Hi, I'm Kyle Carroza, the Kyle of TV's Kyle, and you're listening to Otaku Generation, and I'm playing with my chicken bear.
Book, book, biggie. Book, book, biggie.
What's Reesh? What's Bank? Well, you know who to thank.
Welcome to show 822. I am Alan.
I am Matt.
I'm Bryce.
What's Reesh? What's Bank? What's Squeak with the OG crew?
I was looking at the OG Link collections page. I don't really have a way to edit it. I noticed that I should have flubbed in the title description of the OG Link, which is, for those listening, oglink.com/OG822. So, hi, hello, everyone. So, what did I do this past weekend? Not entirely a lot that's worth talking about from the podcast perspective. I felt the need, for some reason, to watch Picard, Star Trek Picard, again. Concluded it today. So, between Friday, I rewatched Picard. It's not entirely a perfect Star Trek series. It's good in its own way. Even though I know Paul would completely disagree, but he's not here to complain about it. Before I forget, New Kyle Lou came out, and John and I at least recorded a Polymatic, so I have no idea when that's going to show up. Keep your eyes out for that. Matt, what about you? Anything worthwhile that's...
Not really. It just feels like I blinked my eyes, and I'm here again doing the podcast from last week. So about the only thing I've been doing is continuing my rewatch of the new Doctor Who series, and I was just watching the season with The Silence and Amy's pregnancy. I was thinking there's at one point they stumble across this orphanage. The custodian has been mind wiped so much that he's like, he thinks that it's 2 years in the past because he just has lost that much of his memory over time. So that's it.
Okay.
I don't know. I don't know a lot about Doctor Who, so I had no comments.
This is the later season stuff, right?
Yeah, this is the one with Matt Smith as the Doctor.
Oh, so okay.
He's like the 11th Doctor.
And then maybe I have seen that episode.
So I've been playing a game called Eikenfell, or... Eikenfell. I'm not 100% sure, but it's like a pixel art strategy RPG set in a witch school called Eikenfell, and a bad event's happened. We don't know yet what it is, and the school's in total lockdown, and you play as the sister of one of the troublemaker students who is already at the school, but her sister didn't have magic power most of her life, and then it sort of like manifested on her all of a sudden, and in a very strange magic, because I guess there's no such thing as fire magic in this world, so the fact that she can control the flames is, I guess, a pretty weird thing. But it's got a really cool battle system. It's sort of there's a grid that you move your characters on, but it's turn-based and more on the side. It's not like a full-on tactics game. But you move around a grid and you position yourself to attack. So certain attacks go a certain distance and, you know, maybe up or down a space on the grid. And so positioning is very essential. Even more essential is that you have to time your button presses when your character hits the enemy for extra damage. And then if they try to hit you, you have to sort of time a block, so you take less damage, and the difference in timing them right and not timing them right is very large. You have to get good at the timing or you're not going to have much fun, because it's not a super easy game. The only thing that's special about it is like there's no MP system, so it's like more magic points. You can just cast wherever you want each turn. Some do have cooldowns for certain skills, but it's very, very cute. I really like the look of it. It's got a good pixel art look, great music. Not a lot to complain about. I'm going to keep playing it for sure. I'm about 3 hours in, and I don't think it's a super long game. It's on Microsoft Game Pass. That's how I'm playing it. I don't know if it's on Steam or not. I have to look. So I'm not really sure what the price is if you want to buy it. And that's kind of about it for me. I don't have much else to really talk about. It's been sort of a slow week.
Yeah.
Or
fast week in some cases. Okay, so before we go on to our topic, let me just say this show gives me flashbacks to many, many, maybe a combination of good and bad cosplay, but many bad AMVs. So our topic this week is...
Fatal Fury, the motion picture, or... Garo Densetsu, the motion picture. And if it sounds familiar, that's because you're right, it's based off of the Fatal Fury video game from SNK. Remember that way back in the day. And as a video game anime, I just have to say that my expectations going into this were not great. Video game movies have a well-deserved reputation for being pretty lame right out of the starting gate, generally not produced too well, and have sort of pointless plots. So that being said, let's go down into the plot for this one, which is that our favorite SNK characters are hanging around with each other, as they do, being contenders for the hot potato title of best fighter in the world, when a tragically distressed girl comes up and tells Terry Bogard that she really needs his help to thwart her brother, her twin brother, who is seeking out the legendary six pieces of the armor of Mars, which will make the wearer supremely powerful and the greatest fighter in the world. And surely bad things will come out of it. So the gang heads off on a quest to help her. And they spend the rest of the movie trying to track down the pieces of the armor. And then they have a big confrontation with the collector of all the bits of the armor at the end.
Hooray.
So this is one of those things where a lot of the movie is spent with the characters just sort of wandering around encountering all the other characters from the video game. So you can say, oh, look, so-and-so was in this movie.
Yay. I don't know. I never was a big Fatal Fury guy growing up, or the SNK fighters, just because I only played Street Fighter, because I didn't really have access to the money you would need to buy a Neo Geo back then, because it was quite a lot. Still quite a lot now, but... So I don't have a lot of reverence for the Fatal Fury series. I do have a little weird reference for this movie, because I think this is one of the first animes I saw just randomly on like the Sci-Fi Channel, like anime block they did every so often. Mm-hmm. And it was like probably the first time I recognized watching this, like watching anime and seeing and like knowing it was anime, like, oh, this is not this is from Japan. Like, this is really cool. It's not a great movie now, but for some reason it holds a special place in my heart.
Yeah. And the thing is, as video game movies go, I think this one is pretty okay. I was, you know, engaged watching it. I have zero familiarity with the characters in this, other than seeing, like, you know, fan art of Mai Shiran and I, the ninja girl. And to be fair, they do have a shower scene of her in this, but
yes, they do.
Yeah. But it seems to be pretty good. The animation is okay, not great. The story is a pretty standard thing. I like the fact that as they are progressing along in the quest, it's generally a case where the heroes are not on top of things the whole time. The heroes are, you know, coming into this late. By the time the movie starts, the bad guy has already got three of the six pieces of the Mars armor, and as they're getting up to speed, they find themselves following good clues, but a lot of times just getting there a little bit too late. At one point, they realize that you know, one of the pieces of the armor is in the place they think it is, but the bad guys got to it a week previously. And then there's another part where, okay, we figured out where this piece of armor was, and in the intervening centuries, this was supposedly the powerful armor of a rival of Alexander the Great. Mm-hmm. It's been raided by the Crusades and taken off to Europe someplace, and they have to dig up some more clues to figure out where that is. And finally, when they get down to it, it turns out that the twins are, of course, the descendants of the armor's original owner, and this is, you know, why they know about it in the first place. And it turns out that the girl's pendant is important to completing the quest, and it kind of forces the bad guy to come after them, since she is sort of allied herself with all of these great fighters to prevent him from achieving his goal, because not because his goal is to take over the world, although it is, she is more concerned because she thinks that her brother is being corrupted by the spirit of the armor, because if you follow ancient mythology, Mars is not generally the nicest guy. He's the god of war, basically because he's terribly violent and wrathful and aggressive, as opposed to some other gods of war, which are all about standing up for yourself and revenging yourself upon injustice and that sort of thing. So Mars is very much an aggressive war god in this anime. And the more armor you put on, the more fully you become an avatar of Mars. So that's her goal for this. It's not so much the geopolitical ramifications. It's she's trying to save her brother from corruption.
Yeah, and then along the way, she develops feelings for Mr. Bogard, Terry Bogard. which is kind of strange because they weren't really that together all that long. So they figured it out. It's like felt like just a couple days, maybe at most, to travel.
yeah, it's kind of hard to tell. But the basic deal is that Terry is coming off of a tragic romance where the previous love of his life was horribly killed, and despite his incredible fighting powers, he was not able to protect her enough to save her life. And over the course of the quest, he and the new girl, Sulia, which is a kind of a weird name, come to think of it, gradually they get thrown together during the quest, and she heals him a couple of times, which is her special power, and he gradually, you know, becomes more and more enamored of her, and it's a whole thing, you know.
Yeah, not much else to say. it's of an era for sure. A lot of moments of nudity throughout, even at really weird times, like random times.
It's very reminiscent of the 90s sort of anime of its time, so not unsurprising in my opinion.
This is from 1994.
Yeah, I think I like the Street Fighter 2 movie we did a while ago, but more just because I at least had one really good fight, Vega versus Chun-Li. But this movie, I don't know, the fights really I thought were very exciting. It was kind of like people powering up and just attacking each other with big attacks without much really animation or back and forth in the fighting. I don't know. It was a little, I was let down by that for sure.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it is based off a fighting game, so you think you get the fight animations done well, but no, not the case here.
Yeah, I was never really I'm generally not a fan of fighting games anyway, so, you know, the original video game I had no interest in this, even well after, you know, this was available to be seen later, you know. This is sort of one of those things that just sort of passed over me.
Yeah. But yeah, you're right. There were a lot of bad AMVs back then that probably had this in it.
Yeah, and you know, you definitely would recognize people doing pretty good cosplay. I mean, for the most part, they just find a jacket that was close, And maybe they
over would, Terry Bogard, yeah,
right. And then they would find, yeah, right. And they'd maybe find a hat, and that was about the extent of it. There was probably better Street Fighter cosplay.
There are fans of these games. I never played them just because I never had a system that could play them, so I don't have like this like reverence for the originals. But I know they're very well regarded fighting games. Yeah. Up there with Street Fighter, bunch of people.
But I mean, you know, thinking about all the bad AVs that use a lot of the footage just from this movie, I'm like, I've seen this movie already.
Yeah, that's very true.
So,
But I, from doing research on this, it appears that there are a lot of fans of the original game, and this movie has kind of a sentimental spot in their hearts. For being sort of an introductory anime for a lot of people.
Yeah, it's weird.
This actually does have a dub. It was shown on cable.
So I saw it.
Yeah, so there are a lot of people for whom this is, you know, pretty close to their first anime. And, you know, being tied in with a beloved video game also makes it memorable to a lot of people, which is, I think, why it was just recently remastered and released on Blu-ray Discotheque.
Oh,
it's available for like $30 on Blu-ray for wherever home video is sold. It's available dubbed and subtitled and in high resolution. So
I don't know if I need a Blu-ray of this movie, but I'm glad it's on Crunchyroll so we can just enjoy it again years later.
And I think the plot is like interesting enough. The story behind the armor is that it was originally owned by a rival of Alexander the Great called Godemus. And the idea was that this armor made him so powerful that due to his strength and circumstances, he was able to fight Alexander the Great's expansion to the east to a standstill, after which they became uneasy allies. However, as time drew on, Alexander the Great sickened and died. And this happened apparently right at the time when Godemus was visiting Alexander's kingdom. And Alexander's generals were like, oh, with our great leader dead, what's to prevent his, you know, counterpart from the Eastern Empire from just taking us over. So they basically ganged up on Godemus, burned him alive, and then, you know, hid all the parts of his armor throughout Alexander's empire to prevent anyone from ever gathering them together again. It makes you wonder why they just didn't melt it down, but presumably considering that it's, you know, magically powerful armor imbued with not only the spirit of Godemus, but the spirit of Mars himself, it was in the major artifact category where it could not be unforged.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. There's a lot of it. I feel like the movie's not as interesting as you're making it sound.
Oh.
I don't know. For me, at least.
That's one of Matt's superpowers. He can take something that is really not very good and make it sound way more interesting on the tin.
It's a special talent for sure.
Yeah, this movie is basically an excuse to have your favorite what is it, Fatal Fury characters,
right? Yeah,
hang
Joe,
out
Andy,
each other.
Terry, they're all there.
Yeah, doing a little bit of fighting, but not a whole lot, and then, you know, taking down a bad guy at the end.
I like that last scene though, where he's throwing the hat. He does that in the game. It's how, like, his victory pose usually, and then they play that song about angels. It's very, very powerful,
and very 80s sounding. Even though I know it was made in the 90s, this is one of those things where early J-pop was very 80s sounding.
Oh, yeah. The lyrics to the song are over the top. They're all about, you know, stand up and cast your shadow on the future. You know, burning hearts, da-da-da-da-da, love, fighting, victory, da-da-da-da-da. And it's very much an exemplar of the age and of the genre. So I give it points for that.
That's fair.
Yeah,
that's very fair.
This was of the age where things were hand drawn, so you know you're not going to get any CG fighting modes, bullet times, whatever. You know, it's made in 94, so, you know, give that for what it is.
Yeah, there are a couple of scenes where they're drawing Mai Shirunai from, like, a weird angle, and she just looks off model. And not like she's prettier off model either. She looks kind of weird. I suppose maybe that's why they threw the shower scene in to make up for it.
I don't know. I think there's always a shower scene in this kind of anime given the time.
There has to be. It's,
yeah,
it's,
I mean, you know, you weren't going to get that in the game. So here's an opportunity to... I'm not saying I condone it. I'm just saying, here you go. Here's the reason people go to see the movie in the theater with other people so they can all be uncomfortable together.
I did not see this one in theaters. I don't know if it had a U.S. release here in theaters. Oh, maybe it did. Who knows?
I would think not.
I guess you see it at an anime convention. But this is definitely something you, like, if you're at an anime con, you got nothing else better to do, and this is playing, just go in and check it out just to see what right. It is.
It's one of those things where you have a big room, and you can walk by the rooms, and you can see the screen. Imagine, you know, having that moment where the shower scene's up, and you're walking by.
You're like, whoa, I gotta go in there. They're watching some
what happens if
crazy
you're,
stuff in there.
What happens if you're a parent with young kids?
Yeah, that's it. There are nipples. I warn everybody here. If you're not, yeah. And very weird times too. It's a very like slips of the costume when you see like a nipple for a second. I'm like, that's really strange to put that in there, but sure.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I mean, aside from wishful thinking, meaning the reason that they made this, I don't know as if there's anything more to be said. I mean, I can give links. We could just end it here. It's a very short show. We don't have Paul's sardonic wit to inform us how terrible it is. You can wait for that next week, maybe. Okay, so with that said, we got a couple links here. I got three. One to where you can find it on Crunchyroll, Wiki, ANN, oglink.com/5GT, 5GU, and 5GV. So for all the things we've mentioned here, visit our website, www.otakugeneration.net or ognetworks.tv. You want to leave us feedback and let us know how bad our review is of a very bad anime movie? You can do that. You can email us at otakugeneration@gmail.com. I'm trying to arrange somebody to leave us feedback. They never do. If you want to leave it in Discord, you can do that, oglink.com/feedback. Or if you want to become a Patreon supporter, you can do that as well, oglink.com/Patreon. You know, we don't have voicemail. You guys can leave us voice memos, you know, if you want. Okay, so I got a fortune here, or not a fortune. The man on top of the mountain did not fall there.
All right. That's probably true, unless he came from space.
or
skydiving, I guess.
Fortune also.
the man on the mountain... Man, see, I always screw it up. The man on top of the mountain did not fall there. Okay, well, I don't know what you call that, aside from, you know, you can invoke Paul.
Man on the mountain.
You think that's a good song? I don't think there's a good song in there. All right, so Matt, do you have a better fortune? Please have a better fortune.
Sure. This week's fortune to guide you through the upcoming week is... Change has both physical and psychological attributes.
I don't know what that was, but that was better than mine.
Can't make a good song out of that one, though, unfortunately.
No, I don't think you get a good song out of that. All right, well, thank you everyone for listening to this very, very, very short show. Yeah, so as usual, please stay home, please stay safe, and please stay healthy. Until next week, have a good one. Bye.